So guys, we have, if you can hear me, then we have a little bit of a technical issue that we are grappling through, but we are going to go ahead and start the session. What we will do is, you know, I'll kick it off with a few of the things that, you know, we are working through, you know, I've experienced in my previous startup gigs. And then for Q&A, unfortunately, I cannot hear you. So what we're going to do is, you know, if you can type your questions on the chat window, then I will try and respond back. So just remember that we only have one-way audio working from me right now, which is I think you can hear me, but I'm unable to hear back. So rather than try and fix this problem on the fly, we're just going to use the chat window to hear back questions. Is that okay? Good to go? Just someone give me a heads up on the chat window. Cool. You know, I think the broad subject here is the forecasting in times of uncertainty, right? And first, you know, I just want to take a second to outline why this period of uncertainty is very different from what we've seen before. So I think there are two main events that I have been through earlier. One was the dot-com bust, which happened in 2000. The second was in 2008 when the financial crisis broke out. In the 2000 bust, there were two problems that happened. Right? One was that the stock markets crashed, and hence equity investments were no longer available. And hence a lot of startups that had started at that point in time essentially were stranded without capital. The good news was that the consumer markets did not suffer. So the demand, to whatever extent it was available, was available. Of course, all of us had over-projected what the demand was, what the number of internet subscribers would be, and so on. The second thing that happened in 2000 was specifically the telecom sector went down because it was built on the same presumptions of demand. So to the extent you were serving to the extent you were serving IT companies, your business was down. In 2008, it was largely a liquidity issue. So banks stopped lending, and so many businesses that were dependent on lending were not able to move forward. This time, there are three or four different elements that one has to watch out for. The first element is because of the spread of the virus, there is genuine downfall in demand, right? So people will move out slower, less frequently. They may choose not to dine out as much as they were doing, for example. They might choose not to travel as much as they were. That is one set of problems that businesses are likely to encounter. And hence, you know, what is your business? What is your customer base? And through this cycle, how are they likely to react to your products and services? Is one important question to ask. The second big issue is going to be because of administrative actions, there is going to be disruption, even if customers are willing to move out. So if we continue to be in a lockdown scenario like we are in, and at least my estimates are that over the next 2 to 3 months, such disruptions will keep recurring, then it's not a question of whether consumers want your product or service or not. It's a question of whether they can physically access your products and services. And of course, you know, products and services that are entirely online may be immune from some of these lockdowns. In fact, one may argue that they might even benefit from some of these lockdowns because consumers are not left with any other option but to access online services. So second is the element of physical disruption. The third is capital. And for most startups, that will mean equity capital. For many startups like ours, which is in the lending business, it will also mean debt capital. And both of those are likely to continue to be constrained. So I think those are the three key elements that are going to affect most businesses. For businesses like ours, where there is a lending component, the fourth piece that will affect us is whether our existing customers are able to repay their loans or not. Right? So we don't have to just worry about what happens with future business. We have to worry about the quality of our existing business because that is not something we can take a choice to do or to not. So four elements. First is, how do customers react to your product and service in this slowdown? Second, what do these physical disruptions mean for you? How do you adjust to that? Third, you know, how do you adjust to the lack of equity and debt capital incrementally? And fourth, does your existing portfolio of business get impacted because customers are distressed? These are going to reflect in different ways for different businesses. And right now, I think the environment we are in, it is very hard to really forecast. So we tried doing this, right? So we had an annual operating plan for FY21. It was close to board approval in February. Right? So we said April to March, this is what we're going to do. And then first couple of weeks of March, we started to see that there is going to be the first order effect, which was, you know, customers are going to access our services less and less because their businesses are disrupted. And perhaps we are going to be constrained for raising debt. So we created sensitivity scenarios to that plan, but they were still a full year sensitivity scenario saying, okay, what if we don't grow 150%, we grow 50%. Right? And when the lockdowns hit us, we realized that none of those sensitivity scenarios and annual plans are going to work for us. Right? So now what we have done is just look at a 90-day window, right, and be able to factor all these four things. By and large, in a worst case scenario, what we believe is a worst case scenario, to see how each of these factors may affect us. So I think my sense is that in this environment, more than forecasting, you might have to do scenario planning, saying these are the two or three scenarios I can anticipate. And I'm going to continuously review every week, review what, you know, which of these scenarios do I seem to be headed towards. Or is there something that I have not anticipated? Now, what could that look like? So for a company like ours, customer demand will fall, right? If their businesses are not running well, then they don't need as much capital. Because a lot of capital we give out is on account of working capital. And so that is the first factor that we are building in. Saying fewer customers are going to need us. And in times like this, we will lift our credit approval criteria. So we are going to accept fewer customers from the internet. The second thing is the disruption. And the reason that affects us is because there are still some physical legs to our lending process. So there are two things that are beginning to happen. One, the whole product development rhythm around creating a fully digital cycle has not been accelerated. So we are figuring out more and more ways that we can serve the customer without having to have the physical leg. And second, we have drawn some policies to say if there's a lockdown in a certain place and a certain business is not operating at a point in time, then we will keep them ready to be disbursed, but will not actually put the money out. The third piece is on equity and debt planning, where, you know, we are relatively covered for our equity needs for the time being. But on debt, we have again set a couple of scenarios. One, for example, is our existing sanctions will come through. Second is then starting to discount those sanctions itself and saying even the existing sanctions are not going to come through. And that then regulates the pace at which we can conduct new business. And fourth is the credit quality part, where we are anticipating that more and more of our customers will be distressed and hence be unable to pay our loans, which means that we will need more people to talk to our customers on the customer service and collection side rather than on the sales side. We are making those organizational changes to make sure we are significantly ramping our capacity towards customer service and collection. So those are some of the specific elements of how we are planning on some of these scenarios. I also, you know, invest in other startups fairly extensively. And I've been talking to entrepreneurs there of saying, you know, what are the things that they should think about? And the elements are the same that I outlined earlier. But I think few thumb rules, no one wins in a crisis.
Right.
So there are entrepreneurs who came back and said, this is a great time for us and we are going to actually do much more business than we were doing earlier. And while that may happen, I don't think that is one of the scenarios that you want to run behind. Because even if a customer is sitting at home and all he can do is to consume online services, there is just so much distraction at this point in time. And everyone will move into a cash conservation mode. So I don't think there is a positive upside scenario that you can budget. If you start seeing it in your data, then sure, you will react to it. The second piece is just planning on, you know, where does your current technology take you? And my experience through both the last couple of downturns has been that as entrepreneurs, we tend to move slower than what we need to in planning for costs.
Right.
So the first stage of that typically is that all costs look like they are optimal.
Right.
So the recognition that there is flab in the organization itself is a step forward. Then we will tend to say, okay, it looks like I can cut 5 to 10% costs. And we will go out and do that. Most of those things will be, you know, like letting your marketing spends go down. And typically that is not enough.
Right.
In my first company, we did these cost cuttings almost to three different phases. Not because we wanted to do that. Each of these moves is a pain. But because we did not anticipate what we really needed to do. So here's the guidance, right? You want to make sure that with the fall in demand that you have anticipated, you have enough money to last you ideally 18 months, but at least 12 months. Right? So there's a certain cash flow you have today. And please, again, don't focus on revenue, focus on cash flow. So there is a certain amount of money you collect every month. There are a certain amount of expenses you pay out every month without stretching the payables. First assumption is that cash in will drop. The cash in will drop because you might be selling less. The cash in may drop because your customers are taking longer to pay you. With that cash in dropping, you will come up with a larger cash burn than what you have today. Divide that cash burn with your cash available in bank. Not receivables, just the cash available in bank. That will give you the months of runway you've got. If that months of runway is looking like 8 months, you need to do something. Ideally, you want to look at costs closely and cut them enough to take 18 months. At the least, you want to be at 12 months.
Right.
Why 12 to 18 months? Is the outlook that we are getting on this crisis and what does it take to resolve it. So by and large, the general view we are getting, and there is no money being bet on this,
right?
It is all very uncertain. People are coming up with their own scenarios. But by and large, what I'm hearing is the next 3 months, so April, May, June, we will continue to see a cycle of physical disruption.
Right.
So this lockdown is there. Hopefully it will control the current issue at hand, but it is not going to end up eliminating the virus. And so we may be open for some days, we might be closed, certain locations might be open, certain locations might be closed, certain kinds of activities might be allowed, others not. But it seems that the physical disruption will continue at least in June. If as a country we are lucky, by then we would have had enough control to say business can resume in some form and shape. Customers will take time to come back.
Right?
They would have gone through as disruptive a period as you and us in businesses. And they are not going to come back overnight.
Right?
So the markets are going to recover gradually. People are going to take time to step out of their homes. And so it might be maybe 3, maybe 6, maybe 9 month cycle before the environment normalizes.
Right.
Until such time, your demand will continue to be suppressed. And more importantly, anyone's ability to raise fresh capital will continue to be suppressed.
Right.
So that is the rationale for why ideally you want to give yourself an 18-month runway. But at least you want to make sure you've got 12 months for it.
Right.
Now, I'm going to pause here because this is probably the longest I've spoken in a long time at one stretch. I'm sorry for that because of the two-way communication, but I'm just going to try and see if there are any questions on the chat window. Can you hear me? Are there any questions that you might have? Oh, is that in the questions tab? Hold on. I was looking at the wrong tab. So I'll just read out the question so that everyone has context to it. This is Prateek from FinLab. We are a digital financial and business services startup company. Do we start planning BCP for our own clients as value-add services, not raising the cost much? Will it help us survive and grow in the long term? And should it be done in all clients or selective clients? Or should taking a six-month cost cut and survival strategy help in the long term? So, I think the first part has to do with how well can you assess your client's business. Right. And so let me again take our examples because I'll be able to illustrate what I'm saying. So while we are in the lending business, we use a lot of business services, some which are electronic, like we use the credit bureaus to do credit checks for the customers. We will use electronic KYC, electronic signing facilities, and some of which are physical in nature, such as physical verification agencies and documentation agencies. So if I was sitting on the other side of that house, the first question I would want to understand is, how is Indifi going to behave through this counter? Right? And we would tell them that while the physical disruptions are in place, we do not expect to ramp up our business. If at all anything, we will be shrinking our business because our customers are not able to access our services, especially the physical ones. And we would guide them that it is our view that between July to December, volumes will still be lower than where we are. But we are hoping that we will be able to restart business and grow from there. So that is the first guidance you need to get from your customers of how are they thinking about the demand and how much business can they give you. The second question is, as they allocate this demand, what kind of players are they going to prefer? So for example, right now we are open for business, but our courier services are disrupted because none of them have a BCP.
Right.
Now, if we found a courier service which had a business continuity planning at this point in time, instead of getting 20% of our business, they would get 100% of our business. Our 100% is smaller than what it was last month, but the share of business is higher. Similarly, there is a large call center that we had been working with to support us on collections. Their BCP did not work out, so they can't support us on collections, and our collection load actually is going up, not down. Right? So if someone asks me, will you, give me more business on collections or less, I have 3x the more business on collections anticipated than it was last month. So we went out and we said, okay, whose BCP is working? And overnight, we have signed up a couple of agencies whose BCP is working on collections. Right. So forming the view of the customer, forming a view of what does BCP get you? Does it help you retain your customers? Does it help you get more business? I think those questions are important to answer. My sense is that for most of these businesses, a BCP is a threshold criteria. If I can't conduct my business because my vendors are not able to conduct my business, I am going to switch vendors. But how much to invest there versus how much to cost cut? I think those are the criteria to look at. I will also say that this 12 to 8 month survival window is not an option. So I'm happy to be proven wrong on this. But my advice to you will be, don't take it as, but my customers are telling me that they will grow. And hence, I don't have to get that 18 month window. Do what you will, you need to get that 18 month window. You thrive in the long term only if you survive in the short term. And again, go back to the 2000 crisis. There are a lot of dot-com companies that just went down in the crisis because they didn't have enough cash. But some great companies got built out of that, right? We built our business. That was a moderate business. Make My Trip survived it, right? Today is the largest OTA in the country. Mockery survived it. Today is a $5 billion company. Bharat Matrimony survived it. It's a successful public listed company today. There are multiple examples of companies that if you survive the downturn, then you can be much stronger in the liftoff. Vinay from InstaVans Logistics, how do you see B2B SaaS businesses playing out? And do you see Government of India doling out with some sort of relief package for startups and MSMEs? So B2B SaaS, again, you know, I've been talking to entrepreneurs in my portfolio on B2B SaaS. I must say that there is maximum complacency in that sector, right? Partially because of the recurring nature of the revenue. It seems like that even if I have lower fresh bookings, my old revenue is going to continue to flow. But here's the story. You know, one of my entrepreneurs, he sells about, you know, 15,000-20,000 rupees monthly recurring revenue per customer. He got a call from a 1,000 crore cash reserve company asking for renegotiation of the contract. So a company which has 1,000 crore cash reserve, not revenue, cash reserve, is calling up an account which where they have to pay 1.5 lakh a year and asking for renegotiation. So I think existing revenue, committed revenue, is going to get affected. It is, you'll also see more cancellations. The fact that you got on paper a 36-month contract does not mean anything. How much is it going to happen is something that is different for different businesses. So how core are you to the operation? Are you the logistics SaaS on which the whole company runs? Might be harder to replace that out. Or are you one of the vendors who's sitting on top of that logistics SaaS? Easier to replace. Right. So I think how much is it going to replace, that's hard for me to comment on. But the notion that our business is not going to get affected, or even the existing MRR is not going to get affected, I would request you to challenge that assumption. Government of India, honestly, I would not count on that. Simply because there are higher priority items that the Government of India needs to cater to. So on the MSME side, you know, the RBI has come up with the possibility of allowing moratoriums. I think lenders will react to that positively because they understand that there is genuine customer distress. This is not, you know, usual lack of intent to pay. But other than that, from a financial package standpoint, I would not expect the government of India to do much more. Of course, for MSMEs under 100 employees and more blue-collar workers, they have come up with the EPF payment and TDS relaxations. Startups, honestly, I don't see any specific steps for startups at this point. Ankur from IMAST Operations, we are in customer engagement and loyalty business. Corporate going to have high cut on marketing rate, yes. So we have now a tough time to maintain. And already you invested last in product and just looking to exponential growth. So Ankur, it's the same set of messages, right? I think the marketing services companies that I've spoken to are, the way they are thinking about this is they're looking at the whole stack of marketing costs, right? So for a typical large company, you know, their largest spend might be on mass media advertising, for example, right? So say brand building. Now that is the first one to get cut. Their next set of spends might be on performance advertising. And normally they would want to scale down performance advertising in line with the revenue that they look forward to generate. Right? So there will be a cut there. Then there are, you know, small spend items, but which are almost hygiene. Right. So for example, you know, I've got a messaging system that I use for marketing to my customers on my own databases. That is probably the last one that will get cut. So depending on what services you are providing within the marketing realm, you know, you need to assess, and the best way to assess this is talk to some of the customers, right? If at the first go they say, no, everything is fine, you know, just request them. Let's understand that everything is not fine. We just want to understand how are you looking at your entire marketing stack, Where are we in that stack of priorities? So you need to be able to project that. You know, all of us were set up for exponential growth, right? But none of us had anticipated this. So I would leave what has happened in the past behind. And I'll again come back to you and say, once you have an assessment of how your customers are likely to behave, plan yourself for a 12-18 month run. Investments that you've done in the past, you can't recall those. Investments that you're doing today can be postponed. Every investment today can be postponed. And again, your prioritization will be expenses which have a direct revenue feedback loop in a short tenure. So I would not invest today in anything where I can't see a 3-month cycle back in cash. Right. So no cost in the company where within 3 months I can't see the cash coming back into the business would be my criteria. But depending on how much equity runway you have, you may take different, costs. Saurabh from Hordes Technologies, what is the advice for startups in initial stages? Any chance of new funding? There is always some chance, but I don't think this is a point in time where investors will broadly finance companies. If they know a team extremely well, that team is starting a company, they have high regard for the team, they may still put money. Right. So I don't think the investments will drop to a zero, but the risk profile is going to get fairly severely. So again, for example, if you knew that you had a set of 5 people, people you have worked with before, who think highly of you, and who will be willing to back you up in this situation, you may be able to raise money from them. Right? If you were thinking about going and knocking on doors of angel investors or VCs and convincing them, that process is hard in any situation. In this situation, I would just attach 5x hardness premium to all those conversations. Manish from Qualtech, we are a lending technology solution provider, MFIN for digital and physical lending companies. What are your views on the outlook for companies like us? I think, and this is my estimate, but check with other people, we would not uproot an existing system. So we may come back to our providers for cost negotiation, but we would probably not throw out our platforms. We will reduce usage of data services and so on because we expect to do lesser business. Now, if those elements are true, then depending on where you are sitting in the stack, you can plan your revenue side of it. I would not think that new customers will sign up in this situation. There's just too much distraction in lending businesses. And hence it will be very hard for someone to go through the evaluation and deployment cycle over the next 6 months. So I would not count on new customers, but you should assess what the effect might be on your existing customers. Nishant from Weaver Story, we are in luxury retail. How do you think this market will behave? What are the options to manage short-term cash flows? Will debt funding help? I would urge some of you to look at, there are 3 reports that I have referenced. There's a report from Bain, which talks about sectoral impact of this downturn. There is another report from Goldman Sachs, which talks about the same thing. There is an India report from CRISIL. So there must be more. These are the 3 that I have looked at. And they tend to go into each sector and say, how are they seeing the impact? So at least it provides you with a headline view. Luxury retail is one of the most affected categories, or expected to be one of the most affected categories. Both because it has a higher physical nature to it, but also because it is typically discretionary in nature. And as consumers start to conserve cash, this goes down. Also, a lot of luxury retail relies on, if I'm a show of value on part of consumers. And if I can't move outside of my house, I can't show off anything, I'm happy getting my office t-shirt. I don't really need a fancy t-shirt. So that's what I'm hearing, but I don't participate in that industry, so I don't have a direct feedback. Debt funding, I think it's interesting. Why would you take debt funding? If your business is going down, then you certainly don't need debt funding for working capital. So I'm assuming the implication is you'll take debt funding and use it towards. That is the worst use of debt funding, right? Because you're just creating a problem for yourself going forward. So typically you should think of your operating burn as something which has to be financed through equity, and you have to create that 12 to 18 month runway using your equity money. If you then think that, no, I need debt funding because I'm seeing demand, I need to buy goods which I'm going to be able to then sell in next 30 days, 45 days, then debt funding is a good use of money. But please don't take debt and use it for your operating burn, because you will have to service debt at some point in time. And this is not cash flow that is coming back. Smedha from Eduman Trading Services. Could you help us reduce the forecast regarding hiring during the post-lockdown period? Let me not try and project, because I don't know the answer to this. I can tell you what we would think of it as, and what some of the companies that I'm invested in, how are they thinking about it, right? So this is the equation. So suppose today I've got 100 people and my demand is going to drop to 30 people, right? I will need to downscale. Now, typically, I don't want to downscale to 30, right? I want to say, if there are good people in the system, I want to retain them. And in anticipation of the demand that will come back once the lockdowns are over. So let us say I decide to downsize from 100 to 70 instead of 30. What that means is that I'm still carrying an excess capacity of 2x of my current expected business. Right. So in most cases, I would then believe that I don't need to hire for 6 months beyond, in such time that I start to breach that 70% of the business mark, whether that is 6 months from now, or whether that is 9 months from now. Right. So that is the approach that I think most of your customers are going to take, which means that broad-based hiring might not come back for the next 6 to 9 months, right? There might still be hiring for very specific skill sets, because those are not a function of large numbers. But if I need a PR specialist, then I need a PR specialist. I don't have that person. I need to hire that person. So recruiting is likely to shift towards, more specialized requirements over the next 6 to 9 months. Akshat from Startup Grind, 3 questions. We've been conducting workshops, etc. How can we help startups and sustain our community in Delhi NCR? Ask the founders. Those are your customers. They'll be able to tell you how you can serve them. This session is one example of how NASCOM is trying to do this in my own individual capacity, how I can contribute. As long as we are seeing traffic on these platforms, right now I'm seeing 36 people. I'm assuming that, we are being able to help those 36 people. But entrepreneurs need help. They need help with empathy. They need to know that they are not alone in this journey. So that is the reason why I'm not coming out and saying, IndieFee is doing great, but you should take care of your business. I want to let you know that all businesses are suffering, right? Then they need help with solid guidance. Right? They need to know that the way they are thinking about the business is valid, right? Every entrepreneur shirks at cutting costs, because for all of us, it means that we might be cutting opportunity. Right? So there's almost a reaffirmation. Even if I know that, I still need a reaffirmation that this decision is the right decision to take. And then there will be some entrepreneurs who have not seen these cycles before, who may genuinely need advice. But I think most entrepreneurs don't need advice. They need empathy and they need support at this time. Talk to your audience. Luxury retail, I think we already discussed some of that, so I'm not going to repeat that. Amit Bajpai, RGIT. What is your advice for someone who has the idea of solving social distancing problems? Obviously, this is a very important problem in the current context. In fact, there is a hackathon I'm also involved in the website is Coronatham, but I am, it's going on right now. Tomorrow afternoon, we are going to have the final jury session. So I can't overemphasize the importance of this problem right now. Having said that, let me also say that hopefully this will not be a problem anymore in 9 months from now. Right? So it depends on what perspective you're taking to it. If you're saying, this is what the society needs today and let me solve it, I think it's a great initiative. If you're saying, no, this is my business over the next 5 years, then I would question whether there is a sustained need for this or is it largely an episodic need. Akshat from Startup Grind, will taking retail businesses online help in these times? Apparels, furniture, jewelry. Yeah, so you know the way we are thinking about it is you've got the industry category, so let's say jewelry. And then you got the mode of selling, which is physical or online. Right. So at this point, for all luxury retail, we are down indexing them significantly. So we are saying if they were generating 100 rupees of revenue earlier, they may only generate 30 rupees of revenue now. Right. But that downscaling factor might be different for a physical business versus an online business. We may say, no, physical businesses are actually going to go down to 20, whereas online businesses are going to stay at 40. Right. So both are adverse in our mind. But they're adverse to different extent because of the physical disruption piece that I mentioned earlier. Now, the question will be this, right? Are you using your existing inventory to run that business or are you making new investments in that channel? If you already don't have an online channel and you're saying, I'll get started now, then you again have to look at the cashback cycle. Saying, okay, if I put in 10,000 rupees in that channel today, how quickly does that money come back? If that is a 30-day cycle, you might be able to afford it. If that is a 6-month cycle, then you might not be able to afford it at this point. Please share the reports you have just mentioned. Happy to. I'll have to just sync up with NASCOM on you know what's the best way of doing it. Sorry, we got curtailed on our time a little bit in the beginning, but I think we've been able to go through most of the questions that have been asked here. I can just only reiterate that please do take each of these risks. Customer demand dropping, 2, physical disruptions, 3, lack of equity and debt capital, and 4, any impact on your existing customers. Please take all those factors into account and do some scenario modeling. Post question tab. Okay, that's Miraz. Yeah. So those are the 4 elements. I hope the session has been useful. Sunil, if there is any other way, we can be of assistance. Happy to. Okay. Since I am unable to hear you guys, I'll just assume we are all set. All the best, guys. Stay safe and. Make sure a company survive through this downturn.